good to see you all out today on this beautiful, sunny Sunday morning. Last week was a lot different, wasn't it? So we're glad it's a beautiful, hot, but beautiful summer day. We want to welcome everyone who's streaming online with us today. Good morning, and those who'll be watching later, hello to you as well. I just have a few announcements. First, we want to say these beautiful altar flowers are in loving memory from Karen Kehoe of her husband Tim and her son Keith. So please keep Karen in your prayers, and we thank you for those beautiful flowers today. We have several birthdays and anniversaries, and there you can see our list of birthdays on the screen. Happy birthday, everyone who's having birthdays, and happy anniversary, everyone who's having anniversaries. So I hope you have special celebrations for all those wonderful events. I just have a couple announcements. Next Sunday, we will take communion. You're probably wondering, what's that going to look like? So I brought a little demonstration, which I know you won't be able to see too well, but Mark is zooming in on it for me, for the people online. This is a tiny little cup, and maybe I'll walk around with my paper over my face so you can see it a little better. Can you see it? Yeah, okay. You're going to pick this cup up when you come in and sign in. Okay, you pick it up yourself. And now here's the trick. Can you see me okay, Mark? Am I too far? Perfect. So here's the trick on how these work. This has two layers on it. One is a thin plastic layer, and it has this little tab. And so you kind of fold this little tab down, and then you try the best you can to get your little thin, clear plastic layer up, and you just peel it back, and voila! Here is your wafer. Oh, I know. I see you're shaking your head. Believe me, I've taken many of these. You can do it. It is the body of Christ. So then we'll take our wafer, and then I'll bless it, and you hold it, and we'll all take it together. That's how I do things. We all take together. Well, if you were up on the rail, I would do each rail that way. But since we're in the seat, so we're all going to take it together, then I'll tell you when to do everything. And then you peel back your cup, and underneath is your juice. See how handy this is? It's amazing. So that, and then we'll have some trash cans in the aisles, and then when you get done, you throw them away, okay? So you just kind of try to be careful until it will take it more. I'll look back and see when you normally do it. I normally do it after the sermon, and then we take it before we depart. You're shaking your head, yes. So that's how we'll do it, okay? So, and that's how we'll bless it next Sunday. And if you're at home, be sure and get your juice and your wafer or your bread or your cracker available, and we'll all take it together through the power of the Holy Spirit, which is what we're talking about today. All right. So I think that's all my announcements for today. The baby bottles are due in just a couple weeks. So please, if you haven't taken one, pick one up. Or if you've already filled one up, pick another one up and fill those up and bring them back. And by the 16th is when we're collecting those for the Pregnancy Resource Center. Well, Ellie's got a beautiful prelude prepared for us. So let us prepare our hearts to worship our great God.
Thank you.
Praise our great God indeed. Let's go to our call to worship. From our busy lives, we have come into this place to experience the power and presence of the living God. Even though summer is a time for vacations and leisure, we are busy people. Come that our activities will not overtake our lives. Let us spend our time in the praise and worship of our great God. Amen. Our opening praise is Sweet, Sweet Spirit. We'll sing it twice. You can stand as you're able and as you would like. Join together in our opening prayer in unison. Let us pray. Almighty God, we come before you to worship and praise you. Jesus' sacrifice on the cross made it possible for us to be forgiven. You await our response through our repentance, faith, and discipleship. You have sent your Holy Spirit as a gift to each of us. Help us to be sensitive to the movement of the Holy Spirit within and among us, so that we may listen and obey. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We'll invite Stacy up. It's time for the children. And so any of the youth or children that want to pay attention. Yeah, you can stand up where you're at. and watch Stacy, or you can stay seated. Good morning. We're going to pretend that we're all this glass of milk. And the opening is our heart. Sometimes our heart is closed and nothing can get in. But if we open our hearts, Jesus can get in. The chocolate represents Jesus. Let's take a look. So, do we really have chocolate milk yet? Oh, hang on. You're way ahead of me. Remember that for just a little bit. Is it better than it was before? Yeah, the chocolate's in there. So Jesus is in our heart, but what happens next? We need to do something more. Let me see if it tastes any different. I didn't get any chocolate, I just got milk. Okay, now let me ask, what do we need to do to get the chocolate to be all mixed up? Carter, what do we need to do? Stir it. Well, what should I stir it with? A spoon. We didn't rehearse, and look how good this is. All right. The spoon is the Holy Spirit. And as we listen to Reverend Mary's sermon, she is going to tell us how the Holy Spirit is our helper. Let's see if we can get on the right track. So, Carter, tell me, what do I need to do with my spoon now? Okay, stir it. Okay, so the spoon is going to stir. Does it look like it's working? Can you see a difference?
Stop now, it's perfect.
It's perfect? Awesome. Right, so the spoon was the helper to mix the chocolate into the milk. Does it look like chocolate milk now? Yes, looks like the real thing. So the Holy Spirit is our helper to make sure that Jesus gets mixed in all parts of our lives. Let's see. Okay, that is the real deal, real chocolate milk. Now, what happens though? Did the milk have to really do anything to become chocolate milk? No. Really, the milk just had to let the chocolate come in. Was that hard? No. Milk, did you hear the milk complain? I didn't. Was it too hard for the milk to be stirred? No. So for us, we need to let Jesus come in and allow the Holy Spirit to be stirred in us, and then we'll be real like the real chocolate milk. Jesus won't be just in a little part, he'll be throughout all our lives. What happens if my milk was frozen to start with? Could I pour the chocolate in? Would anything happen? It wouldn't, it just kind of sit there. Yeah, it would just kind of sit there. Could I stir it up? No, so we don't want our hearts to be frozen and not let Jesus and the Holy Spirit in. What would happen if I only stirred just a little bit? It won't be chocolate milk, okay? And the chocolate, and chocolate was Jesus. Where would Jesus end up in my glass if I didn't stir it really good? On the bottom. And we don't want Jesus to be at the bottom of our lives. We want Jesus and the Holy Spirit to be mixed in all of our lives. Let's say a little prayer. Dear God, we thank you so much for sending us, first of all, Jesus,
and then also the Holy Spirit to be our helper. Please open our hearts, Lord, so that you may pour Jesus and the Holy Spirit into us, so that we know your great love and share that love with others. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Good job, guys. Thanks for helping.
Give Stacy some love. Thank you, Stacy. It's time now for our joys and concerns in our prayer time. I have joys to tell you that Tom Powers, son of Kathleen and Walter, is home, and he's still recovering from COVID, but at least he's home. So your prayers have been effective, and keep praying for him. Walter, Kathleen's husband, has started his next round of chemo for his leukemia. So please keep Walter in your prayers as he continues to do that and fight that terrible cancer. We also want to say that Randall Ferris is doing much better. The antibiotics he's on is helping him greatly, but we'll keep continuing to pray that that continues to be a help to him. Maybe you saw the prayer concern that Laurel Ebersol had a bicycle accident and hurt her thumb. She's doing much better, but keep praying for her because Mike said she keeps banging it on things. That would be very painful. So keep praying for her. And Tammy Pulver, Rosemary Miller's, the Miller's daughter, who has been battling cancer, also got a fever this past week and was in the hospital, but she is better and home. They never did figure out what was going on with that. But just keep praying for all these folks who are battling cancer and the folks that are continuing to improve in their health issues. Please continue to pray for this cure or something for COVID-19. It really disrupts people's lives when they get it and get it so badly that they have to be hospitalized. A lot of people don't, work won't cover a lot of it, and they're really at economic hardships. So please pray for them and other people who are dealing with economic hardships during this time. Please, you're doing a great job. Just keep wearing your mask. I'm so proud of you all are doing such a great job doing that. And I hope you at home are doing a great job staying distant and keeping your hands clean and being safe. All right, friends. Well, let's go to our great God at this time. I'll lead us in a pastoral prayer, and then we'll all join together in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. As we quiet our hearts before you, great and loving God, we know you know us full well. You know us inside and out, that nothing is hidden from you. But you invite us into a relationship with you. You don't force your way into our lives, though you know us. And so, Lord, right now, as you're examining us, we do invite you in. And we know that through the blood of Jesus, our sins are washed whiter than snow. And so we confess those sins to you right now and ask that you do remove them from us and the temptations to continue to fall back in them. Lord, we do pray that your Holy Spirit just come upon us and that we be stirred up so that the love of Jesus and his lordship can show in every area of our lives, that we can be people of good and amazing faith, and that we can be conquerors in all areas of our lives. Today, O Lord, we give you thanks for the healings that we've seen this week, and we ask your continued blessing on all those we've lifted up. We lift up our military personnel and their families and ask your continued protection on them. We thank you for the freedom we have in this country to gather and to worship. We thank you for the technology, and we just pray that you continue to bless everyone who helps us to be as close to you as we possibly can. We ask, O Lord, that you empower us this week to spend more time with you, praying and talking and listening to all that you have to say to us. Help us to study your word, and through the Holy Spirit, open our hearts and minds to receive all that you would give us. We do pray for all our medical personnel and those people who are on the front lines, that you continue to protect them and their families. We pray for those battling COVID-19, that you will deliver them and strengthen them, and we're especially mindful of Tom right now, that your healing will continue to rest upon him. Let his family know your peace and protection, too, as he continues this healing process. We ask, O Lord, that you be near the researchers and that you guide those people who are fighting for cures for things like COVID-19 or at least vaccines, but also for cancer and all the other challenges in our world that we face through health. Lord, let us feel peace today that you are with us, walking with us and guiding us. We know you know the hidden things in our hearts, and so the things that we have not spoken, we also give to you right now. Lord, as we come to you, heal us, strengthen us, and renew us. Create within us a right spirit that we might live faithfully as your people in this hurting and broken world, that we might be your faithful witness in many different ways. Lord, we give all these things to you, our spoken and unspoken concerns, in the precious and powerful name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we continue in our time of prayer, praying as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our next song is Sweet, Sweet Spirit. Oh, no, we already sang that. It's Spirit of the Living God. We're going to sing it twice. And we're thankful Bruce is with us to lead us. You may remain seated as you sing. Thank you, Bruce. Well, we are looking at the Holy Spirit today, which is not something when I was growing up in the church that we talked about too much. And so our passage today is coming from Romans chapter 8. Romans 8 is another go-to passage for me. If you're seeing a theme as I'm starting in my relationship with you, I'm giving you all my go-to passages. So you know what, last week we talked about the foundations, we've been talking about that. And so here's another key piece is Romans 8 in many ways. But we're going to look at just a couple verses, 18, 19, because I just love those verses and I want to remind myself of it and the challenges that we face. And then we'll go into really the meat of what we're talking about today. So share God's word with me today from Romans 8. We're looking at 18 and 19 and then 24 through 28. So share with me God's word. Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later. For all creation is waiting eagerly for that future day when God will reveal who his children really are. We are given this hope when we were saved. If we already have something, we don't need to hope for it. But if we look forward to something we don't yet have, we must wait patiently and confidently. And the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. And the Father, who knows all hearts, knows what the Holy Spirit is saying. For the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, a minister and a bus driver were at the gates of heaven waiting to get in. And the bus driver was in front of the minister. And so St. Peter greeted the bus driver and he said, "Well, hey there, I think you were a bus driver. That's what we have down. Is that right?" Yep, that's me. And he said, "Oh, wonderful. Welcome. Come on into heaven. And I'm in charge of housing. So you see that mansion just over that hilltop?" And the minister could see, too, where he was standing. They both looked, and it was amazing, glistening in the light of the glory of God in heaven. It was so beautiful. And the bus driver's eyes got real big, and the minister's eyes got real big. And the minister thought to himself, "Wow, if that's the house for a bus driver, what does my house look like?" Well, the bus driver went on his way, and the minister stepped up there, and St. Peter said, "Well, hi there, Pastor, hey." And he said, "I understand you're a minister, right?" "Yep, that's right." And he goes, "Well, you see that tiny little camper over there in the valley? That's your home." And before St. Peter could hardly get it out of his mouth, the pastor said, "What? What are you talking about? I have preached the gospel for 40 years. I have taught classes. I have taught people about the Lord for 40 years. I just don't understand why a bus driver gets this big mansion and I get this little camper over here." And St. Peter just shook his head sadly and he said, "Well, Pastor, when you preached, we show that everybody fell asleep. But when he got behind the wheel of that bus, everybody prayed." You've heard that old one before, I'm sure. It's a groaner, the kind I like. Now, all I can see out there of your faces are your eyes. So I want to see them open. Got it? Good. We're talking about the roles of the Holy Spirit today, and I do this sermon with a little fear and trepidation. I am a little intimidated by the Holy Spirit. What about you? When we were getting ready to move a couple of moves ago, we had a church member who came and helped us to help us. We didn't need to because we had professional movers. But somehow we got in some conversation, even though we'd been his pastor for 5 years. We hadn't heard him say this. And he said, "Well, you know, we're armpit Methodists." Are you all armpit Methodists here? I hope you're not at home, but you might well be. Armpit Methodists, you know, sit around with you're waiting. You wait to see. But the experience I've had with people who are filled with the Holy Spirit, you know, they're very expressionist. Have you ever been to places where they raise their hands, they shout, they say, "Amen"? That's just a small, that's a very tiny expression, holding your hand up and saying amen. That's very small. But I have been to a church, because when I was in college, I was exploring different faith traditions. I was United Methodist, but I wanted to see different Christian churches to see if I was going to stay United Methodist. That's before I became a pastor, of course. And I went to lots of different, I had different friends from all over the place because, you know, I'm very social. And so I went to a church that was very spirit-filled. And that evening, they had people who were speaking in tongues And that was a language I couldn't understand. Nobody was interpreting, so I don't know what they were saying. And they had people on the floor. That was an exciting event for me. And I realized that's not for me. That's not an expression of faith that I'm comfortable with. But that is an expression of faith that is valid. I'm not going to say that that's not an expression of faith that is valid. But as we look at Romans 8, the good news I have for all of us is that doesn't mean if you're not doing those things. See, my problem with some of my friends with that was like, if they were like, well, you should pray for that gift and you should be doing that things. And I even at one point in my faith journey had someone tell me, if you don't have the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and they meant expressed the way they were saying it, then I wasn't saved. Now, that was fighting words with me, friends, I'll tell you that. So, in the love of Jesus, of course. But that is not what our passage in Romans tells us. If you look at Romans 8, we don't see anything about these. They are in the scriptures. It's not invalid. But that is not the main duties of the Holy Spirit. And that's not necessarily how this Holy Spirit's going to be expressed in your life or in mine. And just because you're not doing those things doesn't mean the Holy Spirit isn't with you. And one of the big roles our Holy Spirit has for us is our intercessor. He is speaking on our behalf before the Lord, or really he's kind of interceding on our behalf when we are too overwhelmed to intercede for ourselves. Isn't that wonderful news that God has that covered for us? When we don't have the words to say, God has that covered because he has sent the Holy Spirit as our intercessor. I find that really exciting. An intercessor is someone who steps in for someone else. And the Holy Spirit steps in for us. Isn't that wonderful? I find that just wonderful. And, you know, one of the exciting things I've read in Scripture myself is when the Holy Spirit moves people from one place to another. Have you ever heard folks having that happen? One minute they're here, the next minute they're not. That's one thing Elisha, and I believe Elijah did too, but I know Elisha's credit because they're like, well, where is he? You know, he disappears all the time. We can't tell where he is. And Scripture records, he's there one moment, gone the next. And in the New Testament, we see some of the apostles have that happen. You know, when they're baptizing the eunuch in Acts, and one minute they're there, next minute they're gone. So the Holy Spirit is our intercessor, but the Holy Spirit, Romans tells us many of these other roles that I was saying about. Now, the Holy Spirit can do all sorts of things because the Holy Spirit is life-giving power. Now, do you wonder if you had the Holy Spirit in you? Well, I would say this, we're United Methodists. And part of the Wesleyan tradition that I've been raised in is this different means of grace. And one of them is prevenient grace. This is God at work in us before we come to salvation. That God's working on us before, prevenient, before we're coming to salvation. And God is at work in all of us. And I would say, if the Holy Spirit is life-giving power, which Romans 8 tells us it is, then if you're breathing, if you're alive, the Holy Spirit is at work in you. Now, does that mean you're going to necessarily make it to heaven? No, I don't believe in universal salvation, sorry. But I do believe that that's encouraging to me, that the Holy Spirit is this life-giving power, and that I can experience it myself in different ways. Because the Holy Spirit then frees me, because he's life-giving power, from the power of sin and death. And that's why I want to seek out the Holy Spirit, because sin and death have a great power in our lives. We know that. They're trying to pull us down. They're trying to bring us back. And so, if we want to fight sin and death, we need to ask the Holy Spirit to help us and to come upon us and to give us that victory. The Holy Spirit is this life-giving power, but we need to receive it. It's like, do you have the cup open or do you have the cup closed? Maybe you've let Jesus come in, but you put the cup lid back on because you don't want to be stirred around. Because maybe you're like me, you're afraid stirred around means you're going to be rolling on the floor and speaking a language you don't understand. I'm not real interested in that. But I am interested in living faithfully. I am interested in having power over sin and death. What about you? I'm interested in being victorious in this world. And so the joy is that I don't have to live in defeat. I can live in victory. If I do this, now this is hard, letting the Holy Spirit control our minds. But that's again what Romans 8 tells us. Romans 8 tells us the Holy Spirit is life-giving power. Romans 8 tells us that the Holy Spirit gives us victory over sin and death, power of victory, death, if we let the Holy Spirit control our minds. And I talked to you about that a few this throughout this time, that I'm a control freak. I don't like to give control up. But why not? God is for me. God is encouraging me. God created me. Why wouldn't I give my control back to God? You see, God gives us free will, but we can give our will back to the Lord. And when we do, then we can have this victory when we let the Holy Spirit control our minds. You know, too often we let sin rule our lives, but we don't have to live that way. We can let the Holy Spirit give us power and control. And when the Holy Spirit has control of your minds, it's like this funny thing that happened to my husband. He's, you know, serving down at Pontiac at that wonderful church down there. And they were having a meeting. And he's new like me. And you, if you've ever asked me for something around here, you know I do not know the answer yet. Even if I've been here these many weeks, which I normally would. But with COVID, I can't seem to figure out what's going on half the time. Like today, I couldn't get the door open and somebody had to show it. But anyway, he had to go to an area that big church to find, and he needed a key, but he couldn't find it. And so he was running around looking for this key while the people were waiting for him in this meeting. And, you know, that's very embarrassing. We like to be in control. We like to be on our game. And so all of a sudden he said, the Holy Spirit said to him, go up and check the door. And he's like, and he said, actually, I heard it a couple times before I went up to check the room and see if the door was open. And it was open. He didn't even need a key. And the Holy Spirit was nudging him. The Holy Spirit was talking to him. And the more we let the Holy Spirit control us, our minds, then we can have these events happen where the Holy Spirit tells us. And again, it doesn't mean to me that you're going to start rolling on the floor and speaking in tongues, although you might. Again, I am not going to limit God. I am not going to put God in that box. That's not my normal expression of faith, but doesn't mean it's not going to be valid for you or other people of faith. And this is crazy to me, too. In Romans 8, I never realized that it made it very clear that Jesus and the Holy Spirit live in us. How big do you think you are on the inside? I like to watch some sci-fi, and I like Doctor Who, and he rides around in a TARDIS, and a TARDIS is bigger on the inside than it is on the outside. It looks like an old-time police box, and it's blue, and so it's not very big, but when you get in, it's great big. That's how our hearts are. Our hearts are big, because God created us to have room for lots of things. That's why when you have changes in your life, like new people come in, and you might, like your pastors change, we just had happen here, you can make yourself have a big heart to receive them in. And it doesn't mean you're kicking the other person out. It means you're just making room for the new people. And that's how churches grow, when you make room for new people. So our hearts are big enough that both Jesus and the Holy Spirit live in us. Now, is that not amazing? Well, here's why I think that's amazing. God comes to us in three persons. That's what we believe as Christians. The Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Maybe you've heard this before. And we pray to God the Father, and God the Father in the Trinity, I don't disagree that there's kind of a hierarchy in how they operate, and the scripture kind of indicates that. That God the Father sent the Son, and the Son and the Father sent us the Holy Spirit. And so the Son teaches us what the Father said, and that's what Jesus said. I don't say anything on my own. I say what the Father wants me to know. And then he said, the Holy Spirit will remind you of everything I've taught you, right? That's how the scriptures work. And so Jesus and the Holy Spirit live in us. And the Holy Spirit reminds us of what Jesus is teaching us. And so if we want to live successfully, if we want to be good stirred up chocolate milk, we've got to invite both Jesus and the Holy Spirit to come in our hearts. And again, yes, it is a risk. But if you read Romans, it doesn't sound like a risk to me. It sounds like, why am I not doing this? It's power. It's victory. It helps us get over sin. He reminds us of all Jesus has taught us. I don't see anything here about rolling on the floor right at this moment. So I think it's worth it. And the Holy Spirit, not only that, helps us in our weaknesses. And this talks about our prayers. Paul and I have family that we're very proud of. Maybe you do too. You know, do you have somebody in your family? Like, I have a nephew who's going to be an engineer, and he's studying at U of I this fall. He got accepted and everything. And we're so proud of him, because if you saw the little town I came from, you and the little school I went to, you'd know what I'm talking about. It's amazing that he's that smart, and he's really smart, and we're really proud of him. And we have some other family on Paul's side, and they're very smart too. And we're very proud of them. Both the parents are doctors, so, you know, we're very proud of them. And they've traveled all over the place, and they've taken their kids to all sorts of wonderful experiences. It's awesome. And so they're very bold and courageous. These kids aren't afraid of things, like intimidated by things like Paul and I might be. But they're also always kind and courteous to us. And so we just think they're awesome people. And so when we visit with them, Paul and I always pray over our meals. And we pray at other times, but we like to pray over our meals about wherever we are. And that's our custom. That's what we do. And because it's our custom, that's not their custom. They do that with us, of course, while we're there. And one time we were sitting there, and I was sitting next to the oldest teenager at that time. And I just said to her, why don't you pray for us for the meal? And, you know, I do that to people. It's my job. I'm the pastor. Now, my nephew told us, now he will pray, but my nephew told us that he goes, you're the professionals. You pray. The professionals should be praying. You might think that too. No, you should be praying. God wants to hear from you. So this young woman said to me, in all sincerity, she said, no, I can't do that. And, you know, I said, why? And she said, I don't know how. I wouldn't know what to say. And you might think that too. Well, here's the great news when you feel that way. Maybe you feel that way a lot of times when you get ready to talk to God. God is the creator of the universe. How would I, as a little piece of dust, know what to say to God? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit helps us by pleading on our behalf. The Holy Spirit talks to God for us. The Holy Spirit talks in God language. We don't even have to use our own language. When our words are insufficient, the Holy Spirit. Now, God wants to hear from you. And we know we're supposed to be people of prayer, because if we study Jesus' life, Jesus got up early. Everybody knew Jesus prayed. And Jesus is the Godhead. Jesus is part of the Trinity. He is God. So if God takes time to pray to himself, you all can take time to pray to him too. And we should. Jesus got up early, went out by himself and prayed. He prayed at all different times. He was such a good person of prayer. The disciples asked him how to pray. And what did we get? The Lord's Prayer. And if you don't know anything else to pray, pray the Lord's Prayer. But the Holy Spirit is pleading on our behalf. The Holy Spirit is begging God for us. And so you don't need to worry about what you're praying. God has got it covered. That's how amazing God is. And what do you think that language is that the Holy Spirit speaks? It's love. It's always love. That's God's language. So if you want to live and pray in confidence, but you don't know how, ask the Holy Spirit. Or know that the Holy Spirit is praying for you, but give it a shot. Practice gets a lot better. You don't have to worry about it and stress about it, because the Holy Spirit is here to help us. You are loved and precious to God. And if you don't know that, if you don't believe it, that's what the Holy Spirit tells us. The Holy Spirit is reminding us that we are precious to God, that both Jesus and the Holy Spirit live in us. So we should focus on this truth, that the Holy Spirit puts us in harmony with God's will. I often wonder, what is God's will? I don't know. Sometimes there's two good choices. How do you know which is the good one? I met with Dave about the missions committee. And you know, that's a problem. There's lots of good missions. How do you know which one you should use, which one you support? You have limited funds. How do you know which ones? Well, you go by what the Holy Spirit is nudging you to do at this particular time, and that's okay. And you know that the Holy Spirit, if you're asking and you're listening, will put you in harmony with God's will. That's his job. So you know if you're seeking the Holy Spirit, that's another thing the Holy Spirit does with us. Puts us in harmony with God's will. Now, isn't harmony wonderful? How many of you have been in a marriage or a close relationship? Trust me, if you have, you know harmony is a good thing to seek. Disharmony is uncomfortable. At least it is at our house. We like harmony. But we don't always have harmony. But with the Holy Spirit helps us be harmonized with God's will. And what are some of the things that help us be in accordance with God's will? What are some of these gifts that the Holy Spirit gives us? If we're not all going to speak in tongues and get slain in the Spirit where we're laying on the floor, what are things that we might be doing to evidence that the Holy Spirit is with us? Well, there's fruits of the Holy Spirit in Galatians. There's seven. Or there's more than seven. There's nine. What if you were talking to people and someone hurt your feelings, but instead of getting mad at them, you forgave them? What if you didn't say mean things back to them? That is a gift of the Holy Spirit. Self-control and forgiveness. Those are gifts of the Holy Spirit. What if someone is kind of not a great friend to you, but you are faithful and loyal? Those are gifts of the Holy Spirit. What if you were generous? What if you decided that you're going to tithe? Woo, that's a big thing for United Methodists. Let me tell you, to be a tither, that's not something we do a lot. But I'm a tither. I decided when I came to faith that I was going to be generous. That's a whole nother sermon for another day. But I'll tell you this. My brother said that I was too poor to tithe at that time. And I'll tell you about that story later. But I'm a tither. And I'll tell you, it's worth it. But that's because the gift of the Holy Spirit helps me be generous. Maybe it helps you be considerate. Maybe it helps you to be filled with love and joy. Those are gifts of the Holy Spirit. Maybe it helps you live like Jesus because Jesus and the Holy Spirit are living in you. And because the Holy Spirit is living in us, God, our Heavenly Father, can do all things for good for us. Now, that doesn't mean good things happen. What it means, terrible things happen. And we know that. COVID-19 is terrible. Lots of other things. Cancer is terrible. There's lots of terrible things. But because these terrible things happen, if the Holy Spirit is living in us because of that, then God can use those things for our good eventually, or can bring a good out of it. And that can happen when the Holy Spirit is living in us. Now, we're all familiar with the term collateral damage, aren't you? Do you know what that means, collateral damage? It means when something happens that's not good, it can cause damage around the outside. That's the collateral. Not the expected damage, more damage. Well, Paul and I were watching a movie this week called Collateral Beauty. And it was a hard movie. It was about a man and his wife, or his ex-wife, who lost a six-year-old child to brain cancer. That's horrible. That's terrible. I walked with a family, Jackson Harper and his family. He is five, and he had that happen. And he died in 2019. And still, I could start crying right now. It's heartbreaking. We're still walking that painful journey. And so when I was watching this movie, it was hard for me to get this concept, collateral beauty. But that was kind of a theme in the movie, is that even in the midst of this sadness, there are beautiful things happening if you will look at them. There are still beautiful things that can happen. And I would say collateral beauty is a work of the Holy Spirit to help us, even in the midst of our hardships, to see God's goodness happening all around us and see the blessing that's still available to us and help us overcome. You know, you're never going to get through, you're never going to get away from your grief. That's something that will not be healed completely until you're in heaven. But it'll help you live better now until you get to heaven and reunited with these people we love. So, we need to be people who ask the Holy Spirit to continually come and fill our lives. We shouldn't be afraid of the Holy Spirit. doing things. I mean, we have to let know that the Holy Spirit is God and all things are possible with God, and God can do what God chooses to do. But we can live so much better if we dare to be Spirit-filled people. And it doesn't mean that all of a sudden we're going to start, like I said, speaking in tongues and rolling on the floor. Although you might. And I'll have to adjust to that if you do. But I can adjust. But more likely, you might be kinder, you might be more forgiving, you might be more patient, you might be stronger in your faith, your prayer life might be increased. You might find all sorts of different ways to be a better witness in this world. You might experience power that you never thought you had. That's the gift of the Holy Spirit. So friends, I hope you join me. We're going to have just a closing time of just a moment of prayer, and I hope in this quiet time of prayer, and you can say out loud if you like, of course, if the Holy Spirit comes upon you, go ahead, to ask the Holy Spirit to come into you anew and to refresh you this day so that as you go out from here, you know with sure confidence God is with you. All right, so let's pray together. Right now, Lord, we just ask that you send your Holy Spirit upon us in new ways. Just fill us. We are your vessels. You have given your Son's life for us that we might be victorious in this life as we await the time to come. And the Holy Spirit is key to that victory. Help us not fear this part of you, but instead let us embrace all the gifts the Holy Spirit offers us, that we can be Spirit-filled, full of love and joy, of peace and patience, of kindness, of gentleness, of faithfulness, of self-control, of power, of forgiveness. Help us, O Lord, this day, so that when others see us, they will see you clearly living in us. We come always through the power of the Holy Spirit and in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Our closing praise is one of my favorite songs, is Spirit Song. So let's stand together as we sing. go forth, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the communion and presence of the Holy Spirit be with you and within you. Go forth in victory, knowing our God is with us. Amen. Amen.